we're opening up the Central Business Architecture Committee meeting. Today is January 3rd, 2017. This is a continuation of a discussion of possible design guideline changes, and today we're going to be discussing sections 3 and 4. But before we get started, I just wanted to review the first two sections that we talked about last time. And mostly just ask the members who weren't here if they had any questions about the markups that Carolyn sent out. Primarily, we just talked about updating it so that it's more relevant to today.
It seemed reasonable to me, but mostly updates.
Yeah.
I had a hard time because I just opened it in my iPad and I couldn't tell what it was really, unless there was an insert of a photo of what the actual ads were, because it didn't come in. Did you print yours out?
I printed it out. So basically all the red is what was changed.
It didn't come out red on my iPad.
Oh
it
that's
did?
Right. That's no. Funny. It was kind of like jumbled, like the design guideline manual thing would just show up haphazardly, like it was very weird. So it's like, I don't know what I'm looking at. So.
Really?
Well, I can, if you want me to print working drafts as we go and physically mail them to you before the meeting, I can do that.
Or maybe if you do it as a PDF.
Oh, yeah.
Instead of a Word document.
As an attachment.
Yeah.
You can download PDFs, presumably, in your iPad.
Oh, yeah.
And
okay.
That should show
so
up.
So the PDF should probably do it, yeah.
We're going to work on 3 and 4 applicability and design guidelines, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I noticed on your redlining, you had like a bunch of questions and stuff on the definitions under anomaly buildings. Is that unresolved? Do we want to talk about that now?
Well, it wasn't anomaly buildings. It was whether there should be an additional definition of a building type for
a new category,
one that is basically a modern building that it has been based on the design guidelines. So it
doesn't like the bus station or the
right.
Not that that's or the police station. Or,
exactly. So these were some examples of passes that we looked at last time we met as buildings that are new buildings.
Yeah.
Like they deserve a category.
Well, I guess
different
that's
than anomaly.
That's the question.
Like St. Jolly's buildings, I think we would want to call anomaly buildings, wouldn't we? Or would they also fall into that category?
I think that's the question.
Yeah.
Right.
And I'm totally comfortable calling this Strong Avenue thing a theme building. I'm pretty comfortable calling the police station a theme building too.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel like we need a new category.
Yeah, I think a term that I've run across over the years is a sympathetic design. It's not restoration. It's not reconstruction. It's new design that's sympathetic to its surroundings. It could have contemporary detailing like the police station. It could be simply old-fashioned detailing like the Strong Avenue. But it's new design that's sympathetic to its surroundings.
So maybe it's just the definition of theme building should be reviewed.
Yeah.
Because the definition talks about it being a building that's typically of the Victorian period. And I think one of the inserts is character or age. So
so then, like, even though it's not part of our district, the new building crossing Birds fit the same as it, in this
in
category.
Florence.
Too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Florence. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And we could define a theme building as something that looks like. That either is or looks like a 19th century building.
Yeah, I prefer 19th century to Victorian.
Okay, so perhaps the theme definition should be buildings that are typically of a 19th century period character.
Early 20th century.
Or 19th century period design, you could say.
Okay. And that way anything that's new like those buildings would fit that category.
All right, say that again.
Well, I was trying to get connected.
Get out the red pen.
So we can change our definition of theme building to something that's characteristic of 19th century design.
Well, I think, you say 19th century, it's also early 20th century too. Because a lot of the stuff down there.
19th or early 20th century design.
Yeah.
Late 19th and early 20th?
Yeah.
Like, for example.
Flexible, that's.
The new building you're thinking of down by the church off of Holly Street, I forgot the developer, you know, the retired, that big home. What, how would that be defined?
Off of where?
The one behind the post office and the church, the new presidential project.
Well, they designed it to be a theme, commercial building, yeah.
Well, if we're, are there any other questions about the changes that we proposed to the last two sections? I think the other thing is that we just talked about, there's a lot of language about the historical buildings in Northampton and that it would be helpful to have photographs of those particular buildings that are discussed inserted into the first two sections. Okay, let's, and also that we should replace any photos of buildings that no longer exist.
Right. Unless it's a good, bad example, you don't want to lose that.
Maybe we'll get to the point where we don't have any more bad examples.
Another chance.
Another chance.
I'll be happy to provide an updated Bank of America picture if you'd like.
Yeah, I was thinking of that. I thought, we'll get to that as we go through it, but I thought that's an example of a design that made that building more pedestrian friendly and in character with what we were hoping, you know, for the downtown district. So I think that's a good example of bad versus
well, I've got it
improved.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay. So starting with section three. We're up to that. Which is applicability.
This is just not about laws. This is just. Yeah, I had a couple of questions on the first paragraph, the demolition of historic buildings. Talking about those built prior to 1945, I think we should have more of a floating date, like 50 or 75 years old, as opposed to 1945. Because that way, as this ordinance lives, that date
keeps moving with it.
So whatever that number would be, I think what you're looking
actually,
at
this,
is
this would exclude pre-war. The Silver State building, wouldn't it?
It was built after 45?
Wasn't that built in the 30s?
Yeah, 20.
It's an Art Deco thing.
I think it's in the 30s, but that would be prior to 45. So
right.
That would be okay.
I'm sorry.
But again,
I
keep thinking that there are probably some good early 20th century buildings that might fall out of that category. I don't know.
I would agree. I think that also then the document isn't stuck in time. It then becomes a document that keeps moving as the days go by.
I think the National Register uses 50 years, but that puts it back in what, 1967?
Mm-hmm. 100 years sounds a little better.
Anyway, that I think would be, you know, worth thinking about. The other thing I was concerned about is that the demolition of historic buildings, that there's no reference to the historical commission, and I think even though it's not necessarily required by ordinance, just, you know, a courtesy recommendation, take advantage of that other municipal mayor-appointed body that's job is to review demolition, whether they could be brought into the process somehow. I know if they're totally left out, their noses are really going to be out of joint.
Well, what is the process when there's a building that is of some historical, does it have to be registered in order to go through the historical?
No,
it was actually specifically these two bodies were separated for the purposes of reviewing downtown buildings, because the idea was that we didn't want to prevent new development of new buildings. And if there was a demolition of an older building, now we're talking about the 60s, if we go to 50 years or 60 years or what have you, that adding another layer of jurisdictional review would be burdensome for an applicant. And the goal wasn't to necessarily preserve every building in the Central Business District, but to have a different kind of allowance for development and change and renovation.
I think with the Historical Commission, they have the opportunity to place a demolition delay on properties, so that if somebody comes in for
demolition. When we were created, we were specifically delineated. We have this district, and the Historical Commission has, actually, originally it was an Elm Street district, and then the Historical Commission and the Elm Street district got combined.
And but the demolition review is citywide.
No.
Except in the Central Business
District. Except in Central Business District, by the ordinance.
Right.
But that was done purposely. It wasn't an inadvertent omission.
Yeah, okay. So there's rhyme or reason.
Yeah, and I mean, it doesn't mean that you can't discuss sort of the potential of revisiting that, but I think the idea was that, you know, well, coming into it, this is the first kind of design review for any district in the city, and there was a lot of reticence about moving in that direction by the community. And so it was sort of a light step in that direction, but there was specifically people didn't want to have the prevention of modification and demolition of buildings, and so gave the demolition review completely to the Historical Commission. I think I should go back and look at the rules. I think if your seat may be slotted as Historical Commission spot, but I'll have to double check.
I don't think there was no Historical Commission seat.
So, I mean, that may be another way of doing it without actually creating a criteria that it also gets reviewed by the Historical Commission for any demolition.
Okay, and then the other thing, is there any reference to the National Register District, the downtown? I mean, it's designated boundaries, it has designated properties, whether that designations of those properties relate to the designations that you're using in the Central Business. They certainly have contributing buildings and non-contributing buildings that are listed as part of that document. And I would think that the two should mesh.
In terms of describing the character of buildings, or?
Well, I think it would be worthwhile to read the National Register nomination and see if there's some language that could be incorporated into this. And also, if particularly landmark buildings, I would hate to see Central Business's landmark list be written, and for some reason National Register landmarks are not included. In other words, things should mesh. They should.
I think that probably makes sense for the landmark buildings. I think, again, this goes back to creating a distinct locally driven process and review and set of standards to be distinct from what a National Register building review would require. And there's still, so it doesn't exclude that review, obviously, when you're taking public money for review, you know, for modification to those structures that are already designated in the district. But and in fact, we've had at least, well, the one example I can think of has been the
first year.
No, the one the not the Masonic building, the one next to the police station.
What was that? Yeah, it's.
Why am I blanking on?
Yeah. I just looked at
the big yellow building.
Yeah.
Christian Collins. Big Collins.
The what?
Christian Science?
No, across the street.
Oh, yeah. Across the street from the police
right
station.
Right next
to across the street
what
from Christian Science.
The Elks?
The Elks, right.
The Elks Lodge. The old Elks Lodge, yeah.
The old Elks Lodge. That had to go through, because there was public money for that, that had to go through a separate
right.
design review plus central business architecture plus planning board. So
was
I think
that
for
short,
those.
The National Register building?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I guess the other piece of it is that the idea was the focus of these guidelines weren't to keep everything necessarily historically intact, but to create more a sense of vibrancy
mm-hmm.
for a downtown. Mm-hmm. So that, I mean, so I can tell you specifically that's why there may be some variation in both the boundaries as well as some of the descriptions.
Yeah, and the only thing I'm sort of fishing for here is that you don't have two totally separate documents that somebody would be unaware of. I mean, if they just pick up the central business booklet and not know that the downtown is listed in the National Register of Historic Places. I think that's good information to include. So just from an information point of view.
Well, maybe
also,
there could be a cross-reference
yeah,
or something
cross-reference
in the
and
guidelines.
Also,
yeah.
I don't know how many people are using investment tax credits for historic structures for rehab. There are a lot of cities that are just, every other building, they're getting the Tax Act funding on.
And who knows if that'll stick around.
Yeah. Well,
it's all going to be
anyway,
gold-plated.
Do you have in your office records of what the National Historic Register, what properties in
yeah.
here?
Yeah, we have the map of the buildings
yeah.
that are included in the
district. And if we wanted to change that so that it would match the boundaries of our district, that would be a complicated thing to do, right?
Very
yeah.
complicated. Yeah. I wouldn't
so
recommend that.
So we just want to cross-reference.
Yeah, we could do that.
Because you have the historical survey of the city, including all of the Form B for a record of historic properties. That's all on file. So
the other thing I think would be easy, because this is going to be much more internet form based,
right.
is to have the link and then it shows the boundary.
Perfect.
And so it describes, here are the guidelines. This is very different from the National Register boundary. Blah. Here's
link.
The link.
Yeah.
Well, that would definitely be a good thing to put into the new
yeah.
version.
Or at least a paragraph saying that, yeah, we've got two different things, and these rules are for this, and those rules are for that. No, that's good as a reference.
I'm not that aware of the National Register stuff. But so. We have a National Register district here that's
yeah.
outlined, as yeah. well as a list of buildings.
It's called, there. I think, Downtown Northampton Historic District.
It doesn't have teeth, though, does it? No, it's just
it's
only
it's
if
something
you're
to try
using
and,
federal money for a project.
Right, right. If the feds wanted to come through and make Main Street an 8-lane highway, they would have to determine the impact on the National Register. So there is that review for any federally funded or licensed project.
Right.
It's called the Section 106 review. We look at them all the time in the Historical Commission. And usually it's a nothing thing, but if for some reason there's federal funding on a project, it has to go through the design review process.
Or if you want tax credits. Or
right.
Whatever.
All right.
But besides the district, there are specific buildings that are on the register. Like, not every building in the district is on
no.
the register.
You can have properties individually listed on the National Register. Or you can have a district that sort of is a, you know, a basket full of properties that are contributing as well as non-contributing, but they're all identified in that nomination. And that nomination has been, you know, on the books for 20 years or something, at least. But it's another source of information that I don't think should be forgotten about.
I have a question about the last sentence in this paragraph, which is quite long, but it reads, demolition of historic transitional residential or historic anomaly buildings should be considered only when the building is usable or is functionally and structurally obsolete, and when an appropriate new building has been designed to replace it. However, an approved new theme building may replace a transitional residential building regardless of its condition. So I guess the last part of the sentence to me seems to be a contradiction to the first part of the sentence. Or it's not even really relevant. Because the first part of the sentence is saying you can demolish a transitional residential building, a historic transitional residential building, when the building is unusable or structurally obsolete, and when an appropriate new building has been designed to replace it. I would just say period. I don't understand the last part of that.
Well, then I think it's...
No, I was just saying, does that imply you're not allowed to demolish a building until you have a new building already designed to replace it? So in other words, you shouldn't demolish, even if a building's structurally obsolete, you shouldn't, and it's, let's say, closed and not used, you wouldn't want to demolish it and leave a hole.
You can't demolish on spec.
I think it
goes
to do
it
like
the... I think the second part is, but if you want to replace a transitional residential building with an approved theme building, you don't have to prove that it's functionally or structurally obsolete.
Maybe that
or unusable.
Maybe it should be described in parentheses as a non-historic transitional residential building. Because I'm not sure if there was a transitional residential building that had some really interesting history to it.
Like Sojourner's Truth.
Pardon me?
Like the big residential building on the corner of South Street, that huge long residential building they just rehabbed.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want it. That was, even though it's a transitional residential, you wouldn't want to tear it down.
Well, does that have some interesting history to it?
I think it does, doesn't it?
I
thought that was why that was rehabbed as extensively as it was.
This is the one on the corner of Hampton Avenue and Old South Street.
Yeah, right behind the academy, across from the schools.
On New
yeah.
South Street.
Well, at what point was it renovated? You mean going back 20 years ago when it was renovated, or just
last year?
That's because it's affordable housing, permanently protected, so they have to renovate.
Yeah, well, but it was done with a lot of care.
Yeah. But it was also done with a lot of care because the guidelines say you have to do it so that it matches. Your new have to match. So in that case, it didn't need to come before you because they were,
replicating what was there.
Right.
Yeah. But back to what Emily was saying about that first sentence, or the beginning of that sentence, you don't want to, I think what it implies is you don't want to demolish an historic building and leave a hole, a missing building.
Right.
That's the need for a replacement in that location.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to demolish any building, historic or not, and leave a hole without planning to replace it.
Right.
But the question is, if somebody was going to put up a, I don't think Sojourner Truth never lived downtown.
Oh, it's just an example.
Here's an example. Julie Nixon used to live on the house at the corner of Bedford Terrace and State Street. So if somebody decided, well, that should be preserved because she lived there, you wouldn't want somebody to tear that down, even if they were going to build a gorgeous building in its place, because somebody famous lived there or somebody significant lived there. Maybe the,
That's not what the guidelines say now, though, I would argue.
Right.
Because it says you can tear them down if you prove that it's functionally or structurally obsolete.
Right.
and you have a replacement.
Right.
In no case, I think this is saying, it doesn't matter, you can't just tear it down and leave a blank hole, you know, in the fabric of the block.
That happens all the time, because people will come in and say, oh, it's functionally obsolete, I'm gonna tear it down, I'm gonna build something new, and I'm gonna use it as a parking lot for the next 10 years. People do that all the time.
Right. And that's not allowed.
Your language precludes that, which is good. And I think what you're saying with the new stuff, if somebody comes in with a super whiz-bang design that's gonna be a lot better than one of the little houses that's there. But it has to be designed first, doesn't it?
Yes, but I think I guess it is confusing though, because it doesn't even say in this second section of that sentence.
Yeah, it doesn't say, the part that's confusing.
It doesn't say historic transitional residential.
That's why I suggested putting.
Then there you go, one more.
Putting that in, because.
But this should be a separate sentence.
If the transitional residential building has no historical significance and it, and
of course it's
really
going to go away,
cares about it, then then it would be okay if you'd put a theme building there. You can do that by right, even if it's not in bad shape. But if something really important happened there, and we want to preserve that site, and even if it is in bad shape, we don't want it to be demolished. We want it to be restored.
Well, I guess. But what we're saying is that if we change that last part of the sentence after however and add historical, we are saying that a historical.
We'd add non-historic to that.
Okay. Is that the intent?
I don't know what the intent is, but now's the time to decide.
Yeah.
What do you think the goal should be?
I agree. I think what Jeff is saying is what it should be, is that an approved new theme building may replace a non-historical transitional.
I need to read the sentence all over again.
Yeah,
so if somebody wants to tear down
segment of this whole sentence.
Somebody shouldn't be able to tear down a historic property just because they want to put another thing there. But if the building's condemned by the building inspector, then it's okay if they tear it down. If it's unusable, if it's really in bad shape.
But that's what the first part of the sentence is saying.
Right.
So I guess you're
saying.
So
the second part of the sentence says, but if they're going to replace it with something good, then we don't care if it's in bad shape or not. You can tear it down anyway. Well, we only want them to do that if it's a non-historic property. So if you just insert in parentheses. When an appropriate,
or it can just
when the, however, an approved new theme building may replace a parenthesis non-historical and parenthesis transitional residential building regardless of its condition.
So, but I think that should be separated into two sentences.
Right. Strike the however and just have a new sentence.
Right.
And
that's good because you're talking about an approved theme building, so that means it has to go through the design process.
Right.
So
right.
You know
right.
What it's going.
Yeah. Okay, so we're through the first paragraph.
So what do we do about St. Mary's, for instance? So my guess is that the Bishop of Springfield has decided to do nothing to the building for 100 years until the building inspector condemns it.
Right.
And then they can tear it down.
It's going to be a hard one. I mean,
and do we want to address that?
Can we even address that? That's not really our
I don't think you can address it until something comes in front of you. Right. I can't say. But so here's that in particular has multiple layers. That corner property is in the Elm Street and Central Business.
Is
it's like
that?
The only property that is.
Is it also on the historic register, that building?
It should be. It's part of the I'll bet it is.
So that would also prevent.
Right, but
demolition of it.
You're right, but they're not putting any money into. I mean, the latest thing they did was just shore up the chimney because they didn't want to have to go through the review to take the chimney down.
But they just put a brand. I mean, within the last 10 years, there's new HVAC and everything in that.
They put in a new HVAC system
in St. Mary's before it was closed.
Yeah, that's why everybody's so open arms about this.
I've also heard some thing about the four systems or
They did that before they closed it.
Yeah, that's why everybody thought it was the craziest thing, you know, and now it's the most beautiful church.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a great band.
They're listing it now, you know, it's being listed.
It's a tough one.
It's what?
It's a tough project.
And Smith isn't buying any new properties, they're selling properties.
Another rock club in a church.
When the Bishop of Springfield sells a property, there's a clause that he has to approve any subsequent use. It's bizarre.
It's turned many of the people away.
But I, you know, it's something, is that something we should think about how to, like, is there a way that we could, you know, if we're gonna, do we have any kind of, is there anything we should put in here that gives us some extra leverage over the situation so that they don't do what I think they're gonna do?
Well, it is considered a landmark building, which is the most, the highest level of review from this body in terms of wanting to see modifications, but that's not gonna prevent it from being torn down due to, you know, demolition by neglect or whatever. I don't think there's anything that we can do proactively in the regulations more than what's already there. Any modifications need review from multiple bodies. Yeah.
Yeah, the right market, that would be a wonderful rehab project for mixed-use office condos or something.
For what?
Mixed-use office condos.
For a primary market, not a tertiary market.
I mean, they're doing it all over the country, but you don't have the market for that.
Yeah. Okay, moving on.
Yes.
Does anybody, well, I don't have actually anything else in this section or the next couple of paragraphs. Does anybody have anything?
It's mostly the first paragraph that I had some questions on.
I had one, there's one sentence in the bottom paragraph, and it's kind of in the middle of the paragraph. It says, because of the importance of maintaining and creating a critical mass of theme buildings on downtown streets, construction of new landmark buildings is discouraged for any locations where they would interrupt the continuity of existing theme buildings or in areas dominated by historic residences. I guess my question to the group is, what do you think the intent of that is, and does that still hold water, so to speak?
I think so. It's, and it's, somebody bought both the TD Bank building and the old Draper Hotel building, and they decided they wanted to put something really fabulous there that was going to be a landmark building. And that would really, that would take a big chunk out of the downtown city building. But, you know, I would want to...
But you wouldn't be allowed to put a landmark building there because... That's zero lot lines. You wouldn't change the zoning. I don't think they're allowed to do that, correct?
Usually freestanding.
Right. Mm-hmm. So it would be a theme. It would have to be a theme building.
That's what it says here.
Well, it might be also the case where
you
might
correct.
Start thinking about where this might be applicable. So maybe they're going to be sub districts. So on Main Street, you wouldn't want that, or on the core parts of Pleasant Street, sort of where it connects to Main Street and maybe out to Holly Street, but maybe further out Pleasant Street, where there may be a block of theme buildings, but then
like these large parking lot areas.
Right.
Could you put a theme building with a parking garage below?
Or like, you know, between Silverscape And the building where Fitzwillie's is, you know, there's that lot, that empty lot right there? I don't know who owns that or anything.
Well, that's Smith Properties owns that.
Oh, it is?
Smith Charities.
Oh, okay.
Wait, between Fitzwillie or?
Right next to Silverscape, there's Smith Charities and they have.
And then the vacant.
They have a.
They're never going to be a building, a theme building, a landmark building, where are you going?
Smith Charities is a landmark building, that's.
Right, yeah.
So could you, I mean, obviously they would never, that's gotta be worth a gazillion dollars, so.
They'll never sell.
So I'm now trying to read the sentence again, because to see if it makes sense or not.
They should make that to a little parklet for everyone.
Well, they are selling off their properties.
So I just put the Google Earth, I don't know if that helps at all, but so obviously if you run down Main Street for this from, you know, State Street down, you wouldn't want.
A theme building inserted in between.
A landmark building.
A landmark building, right, inserted between the theme buildings.
Right, but, or on this section of Pleasant Street, I think all the way down to Pearl Street. But beyond that, you know, let's say in this parking, I don't know if you can see the cursor there, but the Union Station parking lot, or.
And then the question, and if you're talking about that, the question is, would we care if somebody took down the Northampton Coffee Building, which is a theme building, and put up a landmark building there, which, I don't know. I don't think I'd want to rewrite the booklet to cover that eventuality. There's probably not a lot of places where there's theme buildings. Maybe on Holly Street there's a theme building, you know, next to the Spoleto parking lot.
Right.
Yeah, I can't think of anybody who wants to build a landmark. A landmark building.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much landmark buildings are institutional government buildings, you know.
Well, it does say where it would interrupt the continuity of existing theme buildings, so I think you're right.
So an open parking lot wouldn't interrupt
that. Right, so there's no continuity there, and there's no, on Holly Street, you know, there's a section where there's, you know, it's pretty space. So that's probably still.
Eat that one to them.
It's good, it's good.
The last thing I had in this section was the very last paragraph where it talks about distribution of building types. And I'm just wondering, there's a lot of numbers in this paragraph, and are those numbers still valid, and does this need to be updated? It talks about approximately 85 theme buildings.
Yes, because we've expanded the district.
Right, so all of these numbers probably need to be updated. And then it talks about.
Do we need them updated? I know, you see where it says see insert map for distribution patterns of buildings.
Was this done before the building on Strong Avenue?
Yeah.
But after, it was done after the bus station. Right.
I think that might have been the first building that came in under the design review, actually.
I don't think so. Because I don't remember.
I think it was.
No, we reviewed that building. I was here. We reviewed that building.
We reviewed the bus station?
Yeah, I think that was the very first building. So, but you're right. So does it matter now if we just have the map and we have the list of all the buildings?
Yeah.
You know, it would just be a link to the map.
You could change it to 87 because those are the two new theme buildings. I don't think any of them disappeared.
Well, we're going to have the Hat Building is going to be a theme building, and the lumberyard too, and then the church.
Yeah, I don't think you need the statistics here. If you reference a map.
Yeah. Okay.
So we'll just have a link to the map.
Yeah.
Just distribute the building
or
type. See insert.
To the list and
So this it says see insert map. Is this the map?
Yes, we have it on the web now. Going to be in this, basically that form, but it isn't exactly like that. Yeah.
is there an actual list, do you have lists of these, the buildings, like, the buildings, specific buildings, where it says 85, do you have a running list of them?
Yes.
Is it worth, does it include that in, or a link to those, in the same paragraph?
Yeah, we talked about, was that at the last meeting, that we talked about including?
The database?
Yeah, but with, you know, link to the picture, a JPG of that, that building, so it's not just in list form, but it has a photograph of the building. Oh, yeah, here's my list.
So there's gonna be a list with a link from every address to a photo of the building?
Yeah, so right now it's just in table format or spreadsheet format. But so adding, you know, somewhere, there's a map ID, street address, and then maybe a little JPG.
Yeah, see, that's where you could put a National Register asterisk if it's a contributing building within the district or something.
Yeah.
It's a college intern job somewhere in this process.
Oh, there are lots of them, I think.
So, section four, design guidelines. And I guess what I would say is I don't think we're gonna get through this. This is like the whole meat and potatoes, and I would like to offer up to the committee that maybe we agree to go until eight, is that?
Yeah, or pick a.
And wherever we're closest at that point.
Yeah, that's bad.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll go much later than you.
So the first paragraph, the only comment I have is it talks about taking photos from 1999, and perhaps you wanna update that to 2017. It may be possible to, if this is acceptable, to just go to Google and get a lot of the images.
Yeah, on Street View.
Yeah. Okay. So guideline one, setbacks. My only comments about this are maybe to bold, there's bullet points for each type of building, and maybe to just bold that within the sentence so it's easy to find it. Like historic buildings would be bold, deemed commercial buildings bold, just because we talk about them. To me, it makes it easier to find it.
Just highlight
that within the bullet points.
Do you want to, is it too much to do a hyperlink back to the definition?
That's too much. If you get this far, you should have read the definitions. Where they are.
I mean, I guess what I would say is someone who has to do this type of thing frequently, and if you're coming into the city and you've never worked here before, just having that quick link wouldn't be, you don't have to click on it, but you know that you can get the definition.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing is I think people tend to go straight to the guidelines without really looking at the reading
right.
The intro and
exactly.
The whole purpose behind the guidelines.
Yeah. Okay. I vote for the link.
Okay.
The photo, so, you know, here we have our lovely former Bank of America photo. I think it would be good if we could add, I think Goggins Real Estate did a really nice job of turning that ugly parking lot into a really beautiful pedestrian entry. So I don't know, somehow incorporating that into.
So new picture and then example of upgrading to meet current standards.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to put in, replace this with a picture of the current Goggins?
I would keep the old one in there as an example of what was not desirable, and then how the renovation of that front walkway is much more desirable and more pedestrian.
Before and after,
yeah.
Always good.
So would you say, so have three pictures on the page and say this, not this, but this was an improvement?
Yeah.
Something like that?
Yeah,
I'm sure the whole layout of this thing designed for the computer, so you can put as many pictures as you want.
Linear, I would
Right. So the next guideline, which talks about building height and width, my first question was, we talk about at least 30 feet and two stories high, but not more than 55 feet. Is there any zoning that differs from that?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess we'd want to match whatever the zoning is.
Right. Yeah. 30 feet. The zoning has a minimum 30-foot height. And now we've moved the height to 75 feet for maximum.
To max.
Mm-hmm.
Is that 30 feet have to be two stories or can it be one story with a parapet?
But this standard, I think, envisions two stories as opposed to the zoning, which just says minimum 30 feet.
Pardon me?
So the zoning says minimum 30 feet. It doesn't talk about stories. But I think for theme commercial,
you really want three stories.
This is what you'd want.
Don't you?
Well,
it says a minimum of two
stories. It doesn't say minimum, it just says two stories. We could put in minimum.
Almost every theme commercial building town is three or four stories.
Oh, and two stories high to any street.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying minimum. Well, if it's 30 feet, then you're going to have 15-foot ceilings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but a lot of buildings, you know, you have a parapet and stuff that absorbs
some of that footage.
So, you know, your floors aren't necessarily 15-foot height.
So do you want me to add minimum here? Minimum two stories? Or does that not matter?
Right, because we don't want a one-story.
Well, what it says further on is the street facade fenestration should be designed to appear to be at least two stories high,
right,
even if the building has only one interior story. So I don't think we can say.
Okay. So that implies it, yes.
Mm-hmm. But
wouldn't we want to encourage people to have at least three stories? Because that's mainly what we have downtown.
Well, I think this probably gets to, again, sort of which sub-districts of downtown, because certainly along Main Street and the upper end of Pleasant Street, three stories, except for those anomaly buildings. But then maybe further out, where we have more transitional residential buildings that might be two or two and a half story, you can see something that's potentially replaced. So, for instance, people are...
The Florence Bank building right on the corner, that's only two stories, isn't it?
Pardon me?
The Florence Bank building right on the corner of Main and
Pleasant. That's four stories, I think.
Is it that tall? No.
It's at least three.
Yeah.
But it might be four.
No,
but I think it's three.
Definitely not four, no.
But the building behind it is only two, where the old Sheehan's used to be.
Right.
That's only two.
Just building there, yeah.
Sometimes what they do instead of a specific height or a number of stories, you can say that the new building, when we're talking about an infill building, needs to be at least 75% of the height of the adjacent buildings or something like that, or 80% or whatever percent is appropriate. Mm. And that gives you some flexibility, but what you're trying to do is to make sure that you don't have this dip there between the buildings. But there might be a place where it would be appropriate for two stories. Would be better in some places to have three stories, but it's because of the adjacent buildings having it fit in.
And could we have some kind of language that we encourage at least three stories, but it might not be required? But I think we should definitely encourage it. And I would say we should definitely encourage buildings to be at least three stories.
Do you don't think the 75-foot allowance is encouraging enough?
The 30-foot?
No, I mean, so you could do two stories with 30-foot minimum.
Mm-hmm.
But when you have the provision for 75 feet, I mean, that's granting you the allowance. Is that not enough of an inducement to... I mean, I guess what would happen if someone came in with a two-story building and the guidelines said three stories are strongly encouraged? encouraged.
And the guidelines said?
Three stories are strongly encouraged.
Well, maybe it can be both three, it could be something like three stories are encouraged or up to 75% of the adjacent property heights.
You know, the reality is though, the economic reality is that for example, if the CVS building burned down and it had to be replaced, some developer is going to go in there and they're not going to put a one or
they
two story building. They're
going to
put this, they're going to max it out for development.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's almost a non-issue. I know you can't assume that, but it's the reality.
I think you're right. The economics, so you just don't build it something that's one story, right? It's just economically imprudent.
Well, how do people feel about the language of encouraging three stories or a percentage of an adjacent property?
I think if it's in ordinance language, you don't use weasel words like encourage. It's either shall be or shall not. Because
mm-hmm.
if we just say encourage, the applicant comes in and says, I hear you, but sorry.
What if it says, 33 feet and two stories high, or at least 75% the height of adjacent buildings?
Well, if it's, we could say 30 feet and three stories high, or maybe we could say 35 feet and three stories high. And, you know, it's a guideline. Somebody could come to us and say, for this reason, I need to build a two-story building. And we could still accept that, but we want to encourage people to think three stories, not two stories.
Yeah, because before, when you're talking about the CVS, if one of the buildings next to CVS has a fire and is destroyed for some reason, then the adjacent part then becomes an issue, and somebody can go ahead and put in a one story. You know, that's what I think the encouraging part might not be a bad. I don't know. I'm just
So how high is CVS? Yes.
15 feet.
16.
Yeah, 16.
So if it was twice that high, it would look a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we'd be lucky to get that.
And I just realized they can't put street view on here because of the way this setup is.
Oh.
I'm using Wi-Fi to project, and I need another Wi-Fi to get on the internet. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And there's a little attachment, and it's in the office somewhere.
That's all right.
It's okay.
Because we can answer these questions really quickly. So next time I have to remember to bring the extra Wi-Fi Bluetooth thing.
I guess my only comment about keeping the 30 feet and the three stories is that then you end up with a very squat building. You just can't do a commercial building.
Three stories and 30 feet.
You can't do it.
No. So that's why I said maybe go 35 or 40 feet.
But the zoning is 30 is the issue.
You pretty much want about 15 feet per story for a commercial size building. So if we're going to say three stories, I'd say 45 feet.
Okay.
But
That would make a change in the zoning.
Zoning. Right.
Yeah.
So the zoning already says 30.
For right.
30 to 70 to 75.
Right. Well, I don't think we want to change the zoning.
No,
we don't do that.
Yeah.
So let's leave it the way it is then. I didn't realize that would be, that complication would come in. I'm sorry.
No.
So you don't think that we could say, couldn't we say something like, the zoning requires, you don't like the term encouraging, right? But we want to encourage that, but we're locked into zoning. So you don't think we could still put
in there? I think that's actually a valid point. Again, these are guidelines. And thinking back to the Lumberyard project, there was a lot of discussion about whether this building fit in because it was a four-story building, but there was nothing that said, that the guidelines encourage more intensity. I mean, there was other language about intensity, but not story. So I think that might have helped people understand more about what the idea about infilling and central business was about, is not to match with the immediate adjacent building is, it's sort of, in that case, was an anomaly to the district, but really creating opportunities for new theme buildings that are, you know, more intense. So I think that in this place under building height, that, you know, multiple stories are encouraged, or
so we could add a sentence that said we encourage a three-story building of at least 45 feet. So it would say,
could it just say something, three-story buildings are preferred?
Because if you go back to applicability also, it infers that, versus manual is to encourage the creation of theme buildings in new construction and mm-hmm. achieving and maintaining a critical mass of theme buildings, you know. I think we implied that all along. I think in that guideline,
could it say new theme buildings are encouraged to be three stories,
but should be
at least 30 feet and two stories high.
How many stories is
this? Well, it says new theme buildings. Well, it could say by zoning, new theme buildings must be at least 30 feet and two stories high. But we encourage three stories and 45 feet high, at least 45 feet high. Could we change it to that?
You could, but I wonder if it even, someone who's building a project is going to come to you and argue, well, zoning only tells me I have to do this.
Right.
So why give it to them? You know, if you guys really want to encourage, I would go back to the language that Alon just suggested, starting out saying new theme buildings are encouraged to be three stories, but should in the very least be 30 feet, or should in the very least match zoning and be 30 feet or whatever.
Well, while zoning only requires at least a 30-foot minimum, the guidelines encourage. So we
just have I guess minimum, I would say what we want first, which is minimally three stories.
We're pointing out that the new police station is two stories.
Two stories.
Two and a half.
Well,
yeah.
It's more than 30 feet.
It's also not right on. This goes to your point about how far off Main Street, and as soon as you get off Main Street, then it doesn't matter so much.
Mm-hmm. It is a landmark building. It's good enough.
Are you rewriting this and are you going to repeat it to us? Are you editing or?
Yeah, just going to send us something.
Okay.
New theme buildings are encouraged to be three stories, but should be at least 30 feet and two stories high to any street. Mm-hmm. Did I miss some words in there?
Mm-hmm. You don't want to use encourage, huh?
I did. But
new theme
buildings are encouraged to be three stories, but should be at least 30 feet and two stories high to any street.
It sounds fine.
Three stories or taller.
We're going to know these inside and out. I didn't have anything on the second bullet point. The final bullet point on this page, my only comment was, it reads, new theme buildings which are wider than tall shall be visually divided on street facades into one or more divisions. I would say two or more divisions.
The last bullet. Maybe instead of divisions, it should say sections.
No.
There can't be one division. It has to be two or more.
Right.
There is a one.
One is
more.
An entity. It's not a division.
So two or more.
Says
one.
Uh-huh.
A part.
So having just talked about guideline two, there's a couple of photographs that follow. It's the CVS building that we've all been talking about as not this, which is a single story building. But this is talking about more than just single story. I don't know, I guess I was wondering if there's another example. Maybe that's perfectly fine.
So you think maybe a picture that shows the fenestration, like oddly proportioned, like there's another picture of that in here, the Hall of Records.
The Hall of Records really got a lot of abuse in this guidelines.
It's a great bad example.
Yeah. But maybe that there should be two examples. One is showing, okay, we don't like a single story building inserted between
right.
two theme buildings, but also showing an example of where the rhythm of the building is not divided the way
showing
that we want.
Showing bad rhythm.
Yeah.
Which was the example of that?
Well, the Hall of Records has absolutely no division. It's just a big flat slab.
I'm wondering, I'm trying to remember, the Strong Avenue building, that system built,
uh-huh.
is that, I don't think there's piers and divisions in that. I think that's one long facade. I mean, it's a nice looking building.
No, there are divisions.
Are there?
Yeah.
I don't recall it.
Let's see.
Oh, is it in there?
Yeah, that's
oh.
it.
Oh, right, okay, yeah.
Nice. Of course, the Hall of Records is an example of a building that is exempt from our purview.
Right, but we still don't like it.
It's still all the more we can hold it out. It's a terrible example.
Do you think in that last bullet point you should leave the specificity of the 12-inch water deep?
Yeah, I wondered about that. This is about the piers, and it talks about at least 12 inches wide and 4 inches deep.
Which thing are we talking about?
So the very last sentence in the last bullet point talks about
right.
how the divisions are created by piers on the facade that are at least 12 inches wide and 4 inches deep, or of equivalent separation on street facades. So in some ways, I guess that 12 inch, it's an example. And so I think somebody could take the or of equivalent separation and make an argument of how that proportion is equivalent to their building in some way, whatever their proportion is. Like somebody might come up with something different that's 9 inches and 3 inches.
12 would be a brick and a half.
Right.
And that way you get a mason thing as opposed to just a
8 or
sailor stack.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's probably good to have guidance for people who aren't as experienced with the,
yeah.
and they can just pick the number. And then you contrast that with the folks who come in and say, well, this is the reason why I'm not doing this, and here's
right.
But the reality is any of these buildings are going to be designed by an architect who's going to be well aware of all the guidelines and regulations.
Should be.
Should be.
Well,
yeah.
Well,
we give
you don't want it to
the
be
link
small.
Of the book, they'll
right,
have
right.
to be.
Well,
say,
so,
right.
But
they're
trying
to get
well, I'm just saying, you know what I mean? Commercial buildings, you can't get away with not having architects,
right.
so they,
yeah.
you know.
And then the
so I was thinking back to that new building down by the post office. I kind of remember. I was thinking about that when they were doing their divisions and their setbacks, and I don't think it quite followed the guidelines and the depths of those.
Well, I think that also in my mind, I was thinking of someone who was very good at pushing back about why their idea was better. And so I think, you know, the architect in that case came and said, here's what I'm doing to address the, and so I think this allows that wiggle room.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember what the number was, but I do remember there was a lot of discussion about the depth and creating that shadow.
Right.
And the same thing for the lumberyard project. Because I don't think they didn't have any division,
right.
vertical divisions on there.
Right. The first time around.
Right.
Yeah.
Came back.
Curved facade there.
Yeah.
Totally leave that.
Yeah. Okay.
Three.
Guideline 3. The only comment I had on this was in the last bullet point. It's talking about so this is renovations to anomaly buildings, and it talks about if if added stories are not feasible, renovations should incorporate a visually compatible raised front parapet wall, which is at least 4 feet above the front roof eave height and is at least 16 inches thick. And I guess my only question was about the 16 inches thick, meaning I guess if they don't want some sort of like paper thin faux facade
sort of
there.
Weak false front.
Right.
Is that what's in that example?
It's a lot of 12 inches typically, right? A double wall with a spacer.
Yeah.
Right, isn't it typically, I don't know the technical terms, I'm not a mason, but like a brick building, you have a front course and a back course and a filler, and it's typically a 12-inch wall,
mm-hmm.
isn't it?
It can be. It can be up to 16 inches,
yeah.
But yeah, you could have an 8-inch and then a 4-inch,
mm-hmm.
an 8-inch backer and a 4-inch brick veneer. But I don't know, I think the sense of this is that it should have the appearance of at least 16 inches thick, that it has some substance to it. It doesn't really matter how it's built, it could be metal framed and...
Where would you see that 16 inches?
Well, I guess, so that's the photograph, which is an example, so you could potentially see the side of it.
Well, yeah,
you'd want a return or something on the sides. You know,
and you know, that backs up to the bike path in particular, so you can definitely see, see it for the bike path.
And in the bad example, you can definitely see it too.
Well, that's more than 16 inches wide. One of the things that I think would...
Oh, yeah, but that's not even...
It's not 4 feet high, certainly, but it appears definitely to be more than 16 inches thick.
But it's not, it's just a, it's
just a slab.
It, yeah.
One of the things that I think would be helpful in the sort of what we like about this and what we don't like about this is, you know, we say not this, but we don't say why we don't like this.
Or why we do like this.
Or why we do like this.
Why do we like this? For the detailing and the massing?
Sure, yeah. I think that it's fine to have just a few words, and I would get a better photo that actually shows the entire parapet, since that's what we're talking about.
Okay. Google Earth, here we come.
You know, we've cut out the top of the parapet.
Yeah. Well,
oh, that's interesting.
I think this is editing on this.
That was cropped?
Yeah.
Maybe when it went in here.
Yeah. Because the original book, it's full,
Original.
Well, but, and then...
The one that we don't like, there's no articulation, the proportions are off. And it's only a single story.
Probably from a better example in that building too.
Yeah. But also with this building, if you did put a 4 foot high parapet on top of this particular building, the way that it's currently constructed, it would look ridiculous.
Yeah, it would look like the Wild West.
You would want to make it look like there was another story up there at that point.
Right. Well, right, you have this whole almost faux story.
I'm trying to visualize what's even there right now.
I think it's empty right now.
No, but if that even looks like that right now, like it just, that's still there.
Okay, new picture.
I look out the window every day at it.
Or a new picture of a different building, even, or one of more typifies
a better illustration.
Okay, we have 10 minutes. Yeah.
Okay, I'm just saying, but on all these this and not this, do you think we should have a little sentence or a definition of why, or just live with it?
I think yes. I think it's helpful.
I think a picture's worth 1,000 words to say something right about it, but It makes it obvious. Showing the picture makes it obvious what we like and what we don't like. And it's, I don't know. explained.
A little emoticon is a smile or a frown.
Thumbs down.
Hey, this is computer design.
Well, the this, not this is fine. We don't have to do emoticons.
Yeah, I mean, that's right.
I could think of a worse emoticon.
Emoji. Okay.
Well, so Joe, let me just ask you though, when you look at this photograph, what is it about it that you don't like?
It's dull, nondescript.
It's also a very poor photograph with shadows in front of the facade, so you can't see no detailing at all in that photograph.
See,
that's quite
like
an issue.
In color. Or you can see on the screen too, but.
Yeah. But saying, this is so dark you see no.
Right, it almost looks like Subway has the same, that there's no step back.
Yeah, this is just a little vernacular throwaway building.
It shouldn't be represented.
There are guidelines.
Yeah. It's just, and it looks like somebody just said, well, I want to put up a building and I want to spend as little money as possible.
That's exactly what it is.
And I don't really have any aesthetic sense,
right.
And I don't want to make the world a more beautiful place. I just want to have a building that I can do business out of.
Put your Mason Center on a Saturday morning and say, make it this long and that wide and that tall, just do it.
Right. That's right.
Basically, yeah. It's a box, you know.
I wonder what's behind that siding, if there's something actually beautiful behind it, articulation.
You mean the wood on the front of it?
Yeah. It's
yeah.
Probably possible glass.
Well, you know, the old Honda.
I was going to say, the most dealerships came down. It was amazing. What was on the effort they went to disguise all that stuff.
It's like.
It was so bad.
It had corbelling, it had all sorts
beautiful
of brick
really.
Detailing behind that.
Horrible Honda.
Like a 1920s deco.
That's early 20th century as opposed to a Victorian era.
Mm-hmm.
It just had a nice detail.
So it's 5 to 8. Do we want to try to do one more guideline or do we want to call it a night?
I could call it a night. I told my wife my meeting was going to last about an hour. So.
Okay, room's not good.
Can I get a motion to close the meeting?
Do you want to continue it?
Oh, right.
No, because you close it for now, and then we're going to work on the next sections for the next time, so you don't need to really continue. It's not a public hearing, so.
Okay. I'll move to adjourn.
All in favor? Deny it at all?
One more comment when you're redrafting, if you're including the Secretary of the Interior standards for building rehab, I think they have an updated version.
I think the best thing would just be to link it.
Yeah,
and not replicate it.
And they have all kinds of guidelines and references how to deal with this as advanced.
So the next meeting, then, the Tuesday the 7th?
That's the first Tuesday?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I think it is. Yes.
That will be it. And then I'll try to have I'll have to remember to bring that extra dongle so we can do two things at once for Google Earth.
Okay. So your
window has been wonderful.
Yeah.
It's time.
Maybe after this weekend.
Whatever.